Thank you, Ilse Kirchner, for chairing the panel. Let's start with Confluence of Ecological Thoughts in Alejandro Albarrán and Hubert Matthews. I will explore the relationship between humans and non-humans through two poems from different poetry collections. Each one proposes different approaches to ecological thoughts. This paper is part of a chapter in progress. So, Alejandro Albarrán was born in Mexico City in 1985. He is a Mexican poet. His poetics have two constant issues, shifting subjectivities and horses. I will be dealing with Persona Fea Ridícula, published in 2017. Juan Martínez Calleja, or Malina, or Matiwa, was born in Malinatepec, Guerrero, 1986. He is a MEPA poet. I will be dealing with his first poetry collection, Xtambá, Piel de Tierra, published in 2016. He has also an extensive number of poetry collections, but I just will deal with one. He writes and publishes in MEPA and Spanish, and his poetics liaise activism in terms of linguistic and cultural revitalization and criticism of the current states of affairs in Guerrero. I will start with Albarrán, then continue with Matiwa, given that the resulting notion will complement the way we understand ecological thought nowadays. Albarrán's persona fea ridícula benefits from Timothy Morton's Mesh. The poem has a striking eye that shifts constantly from one body to another. However, the image of a winged blind horse stands out from the rest. During the book launching, Albarrán stated that horses reminded him of an animal de poder, that is, a nahual or spirit animal. In popular mestizo culture, a nahual is a way to identify powerful animals or humans that shift appearances. The horse in the poem has a peculiar configuration due to the relationship established with the landscape. For the sake of time, I will display it on screen rather than read it. According to these lines, every experience could become landscape. The latter contradicts the term itself because the etymology includes the segmentations of the land and the partial representation of it. The opposite happens. A sightless experience encompasses all possibilities or segmentations, up to the point of becoming an infinite and boundaryless accumulation of experiences. The poem then sets a crisis in the notion of landscape, regarded as something quite partial and graspable. Furthermore, the poem intensifies in a rather gruesome image. The horse god ends up pairing with external experience of the unlimited landscape. Although violent, evisceration is a common practice to death cattle in order to prevent rotted corpses from exploding. The inclusion of rural, unidyllic images shows the constant life that cycle and remarks that the horse's abdominal contents are part of a landscape, meaning they are constituent of what animals experience too. The horse becomes a landscape, likewise, the landscape devolves all other images in the poem, horse and its entrails included. Albarrán's poem brings about an immediate experience of so-called landscape, not in, but within the environment. The interconnectedness shown could be an example of Morton's Mesh. Morton discovered that nature seemed distant from humanity, or rather seems the opposite of human experience. The Mesh notices that the relationship between humans and non-human is actually connected. Albarrán's image of this landscape with horses and entrails included depicted this unlimited space. Albarrán takes a step closer to some aspects of Matiwa's poetics. In terms of making visible the relationship between humans, human and non-humans, but it stops there once this interconnection is established. Matthew's Xtamba, Piel de Tierra, actually starts with interconnectedness. The liaison between Xabomepa, their territory, some aspects of their culture and rural life are visible in Ningunda Ashua or Soñaron los Perros. In the poem, both humans and non-humans become participants of actions and aspects of communities' life and rituals. The act of dreaming extends to dogs, the night, the road, the rainstone, and the tree. As the poem goes on, the agents move towards a politically charged course of events. Once the dog dreams about being dressed up with stars and take away the fright from people, the rainstone, which is a deity that nurtures Xabomepa, dreams about Tu nombre nuestro brazo. From that moment on, the foundational tree dreams about sprouting people whilst rebelliousness grows within them. In the verse, Tu nombre nuestro brazo, the arm could be an allegory of the community's strength. Yet the most puzzling part is the idea of the pronoun, nuestro or our, can be inclusive or exclusive. That is, it can include the readers and other people outside the community or not. This bit actually is absent in Spanish version because that kind of dichotomy is not present in the Mexican Spanish. The MEPA version might allude to the exclusive pronoun, reinforcing this idea of strength within the community, within non-humans, without allyship with other humans' communities. Gloria Chacón's term capable allows us to understand inclusion and exclusion of readers and others. In indigenous people's poetry and philosophy or way of life, Chacón uses cosmoleptics as a neologism, cosmology, and dialectics that explains how indigenous people's poetry and thought transgresses disciplinary boundaries between cosmology, philosophy, and poetry. At the same time, she uses the term capabil as a way to signify a vision that duplicates. Capabil permits to regard past and present simultaneously, altering Westernized sense of chronology. Thus, in Ningunda Ashuan, Soñaron los Perros, the past alluded with the fragments of cosmogony goes hand in hand with the present referred by the fright, the rebelliousness, and the offspring. Capabil also displays strategies that define Westernized logic, given that non-humans acquire the same skills that humans possess, dreaming, leading those dreams forward, and so on. Both humans and non-humans jointly configure the space where they live. Moreover, the last trove finds a way outside oppression, where the joint dream consists of a rebellious offspring. Capabilian's strategies in Matthew's poetics deal as well with ecological thought, because the poetry collection let readers know that for Xabomepa, cosmolectics, being in the world means to simultaneously bind yourself within a collectivity, potentially becoming and caring for non-humans, as well as being and becoming territory understood as political right, but also as a mythical foundation, and varying with each action, yours and others' life cycles. In exchange for that, MEPA peoples are born by those non-humans with whom they closely relate. People from La Montaña then would prevail because the environment, the non-humans, support, fill, and organize with them. As we can see, Albarrán and Matthew's text presents some of this diversity displayed in Mexican poetries and territories. Ecological thought take a rather abstract shape in Albarrán and have a strong cosmological, cosmolectic, and Kababelian strategy in Matthieu's case. Both poetics prove interconnectedness between humans and non-humans as a possibility. What is more important is that both were far from idealizing being one with nature. And we need that kind of lessons in order to reassess our ecological thought and actions. That will be it for this paper. Thank you all for listening. And back to Ilka and the panel.